Last night on NBC, they did a feature piece on some of the soldiers that served with then-private, now Sergeant Bergdahl, the serviceman, the POW that we exchanged five Taliban detainees for. And I heard last night from his former platoon leader that
he willfully left. He had premeditated, planned out, and left. He deserted not only the Army, but he also left myself and my platoon and my company to clean up his mess.
Now, it's very easy for talk show hosts to be judgmental of servicemen and women in combat situations, to get inside their heads and decide that they did right or they did wrong. Let's talk to somebody who's actually been there in combat, a former POW during the Vietnam War. Want to talk to him maybe about the swap here, or the deal we cut with the Taliban. And then perhaps if time permits, we can talk about Hanoi Jane speaking, giving a commencement address at UCLA, how he feels about that. He's written a great book, Leading with Honor, Leadership Lessons from the Hanoi Hilton. We welcome to the program Colonel Lee Ellis. Colonel, welcome to the program, and thank you for your service to our country.
Thank you, John. Good morning. Good to be with you today.
We'd like to start with your thoughts on Sergeant Bergdahl and the swap.
Well, I've kind of been waiting and watching to see things unfold a little bit. I'd heard for some period over the years, because I was connected to a lot of people who were concerned about him and interested in his welfare and raising awareness about him. But I'd also heard that there were some issues of his possibly being a deserter. And so I've just kind of laid on the sidelines waiting to hear. And now it sounds like more and more information is coming out about his true status. You know, we have a code of conduct, military code of conduct, and one of the articles says, I will never surrender my own free will, and that we are to resist the enemy. I was surrounded by the enemy, and I resisted at right to eight until about 20 of them surrounded me with their rifles, and I couldn't shoot my way out, I couldn't run, and I had to surrender, which led to 5.5 years as a POW. So I've kind of been in that situation. I remember 1968 when the president started the bombing, and we didn't hear any bombs falling around Hanoi for almost 4 years. So, but we knew our job was to sit and wait and to trust our country to get us out in appropriate time. In this situation, it's looking more and more like he probably was deserting. It sounds that way, if that many people are saying that. So then that leads to question about, you know, the questions about judgment and this negotiated release and what was that all about? And I think people are rightly asking questions about it. I don't know what the president had in mind yet. He obviously has a lot of information we don't have. But as an outsider, to a simple person looking at it, it just raises a lot of issues of why would you do that? Why would you trade high five, high values for one deserter, which it appears to be? Now, as a father, obviously I'd want my son home regardless of what the situation was. So, you know, we have roles of family, we have roles in leadership. The president has a role in leadership of the country, and so that's a different role than being a father. So I'd say it's all unfolding, and we'll just have to wait and see how it's going to play out.
Colonel, I spoke with another Vietnam vet yesterday who said maybe, you know, he did sympathize with the Afghan people, and he left his base, but maybe then he changed his mind. Maybe he tried to go back but couldn't, and we as Americans, we had to be there for him.
Well, I think we always have to be there for him, for our people, and even, you know, if he wasn't taking up arms and fighting against us every day, yeah, I think we have to be there, and we have to have some mercy and understanding. The question raises here, though, is what's an appropriate trade? And I'm probably not in a position to make that decision because I don't have the legal counsel. I don't have the, you know, people surrounding me. I wasn't able to sit down with the leaders of both parties and discuss what their thoughts would be from an American foreign policy perspective. So I think there are a lot of pieces to it here. I'm just saying from a simple perspective of being a military guy, once upon a time, it doesn't make a lot of sense yet to me.
Yeah, we overpaid probably. But let's go back to what it's like to survive 5 years plus in a prison camp in North Vietnam. I know you flew for the Air Force. Senator McCain, obviously a Navy pilot, but I'm sure you knew each other at least if not there afterwards. How do you survive 5 years just sitting there and from time to time being tortured? And also, you could have been bombed by friendly fire at any time. How do you get your mindset, and how do you survive that?
You do it one day at a time. I think that's the way we actually do life anyway, is one day at a time. It's just there. You don't have the TV, radio, magazines, newspapers, internet, any of that stuff. You just do it one day at a time to the best of your ability. In our case, our responsibility was to do our duty, to resist the enemy, to be faithful to our fellow POWs, to be faithful to our country, and hang on and survive until we could one day go home. Obviously, they were trying to extract propaganda from us, and so that was the battle. Day-to-day, the war in the POW camps was resisting the enemy and not collaborating with them and not giving them aid and comfort or propaganda.
What was the worst day while you were a prisoner of war?
Well, there were a number of bad days. There were a lot of good days, actually, but probably the first time I was tortured and I was laying in leg irons and handcuffs on a filthy floor and feeling like I'd let my country down. I felt like a failure. I feel like I was weak because I wasn't able to totally resist them and not give them anything. I eventually agreed to fill out a 3-page biography after resisting for quite a while, but I didn't give them any information. The only information I gave them that was true was my father's first and last name and my name, service number, rank, and date of birth. So I really didn't give them anything, but the fact that I was not strong enough to laugh at them and give them nothing at all made me feel very, very down and let down. And of course, later I found out that my other POW friends had gone through the same thing and ended up in the same place. And so that was some encouragement, but it was always, it always stayed with me a little bit how powerless I felt, I guess would be the right word.
But you never gave up hope.
No. Never gave up hope. I always believed that someday I'd be going home. I think there are two things, you know. You got to do it one day at a time, and you never give up hope.
I remember watching you guys step off that plane. The whole country was watching the day you came home. Talking to Colonel Lee Ellis, his book is Leading with Honor, Leadership Lessons from the Hanoi Hilton, a former POW. We talked about the situation with Sergeant Bergdahl. We learned today that Jane Fonda is giving a commencement address, the one at the theater school at UCLA. A lot of Vietnam veterans have been quoted as saying, we just hate her because she gave aid and comfort to the enemy while we were there fighting in the jungles, or in your case, as a prisoner of war. That being said, should UCLA ever book somebody as controversial as Jane Fonda, or should she be allowed to give her address, in your opinion?
Well, it's a free country, and people can make choices to do whatever they want to do. I choose not to hate Jane Fonda just because I don't want to give her that much of my energy and my space and my brain and my emotions. I believe had she been tried in a legitimate court, she could have been convicted of treason because she did aid and abet the enemy. She did make an audio tape that was played for the POWs to encourage us to go along with the North Vietnamese and help end the war. So that was certainly aiding and abetting. So, you know, she did what she did. You reap what you sow. Unfortunately, the people at UCLA see the world a little differently than I do. I believe there are consequences for actions. There are consequences for bad judgment. There are consequences for breaking the law. And so I would, if it were me, I wouldn't invite her. I would just let her go on her way and, you know.
Colonel, did you hear those tapes? Sorry for interrupting. Did you hear those tapes while you were a prisoner of war?
Yes, I did hear that. It was just one tape, and I did hear it. Now, I will say that most of the internet messages that you get about Jane Fonda are lies. Those are not true. I don't know where that came from, but our POW group and us as individuals, we deny that. But we also say that she did enough, or I say, and I think most of my friends say, is that she did enough to be convicted of treason.
Yeah, well, you are there aiding and abetting the enemy on their soil where our prisoners are just a couple miles away. Yeah, that's problematic. That's different than being an outspoken, vocal critic of the war at home, protesting peacefully. That's, sir, you draw that distinction as well, Colonel.
Absolutely. In fact, we defended the anti-war demonstrators to our captors, they would try to show us pictures of it and tell us about it, mm-hmm. and so use that to convince us that we should also cross over and make anti-war statements. And we said, look, this is what this war is all about. We're about freedom, and freedom of speech is so valuable to us that we are happy for our people to be able to go out and demonstrate. Now, not happy for them to destroy property at the university or somebody's business, but certainly happy for them to demonstrate and protest the war. So that would have been great for her to do that, but she crossed over a line, I think.
Hey, one other, this is a political question. If you want to pass on it, I certainly understand. But as somebody who has been a prisoner of war, if you were advising the President of the United States, Republican or Democrat, what to do with the remaining detainees in Gitmo, do you think that is the only place we can deal with these people? And again, this is a very political question. I don't want to mean to put you on the hot speed or sand, or hot seat or sandbag you. But I think it's corrosive to our national identity to have people that we do not process through some sort of a judicial process, whether it's civilian court or a military tribunal. I would lean towards a military tribunal because I believe they're enemy combatants. But to leave them hanging, in essence, with no resolution, I think that's corrosive to us. Your thoughts?
Well, the way you put it just there, I would say I probably agree with you. It's been about 10, I don't know how many years now, 10 years since all that started, and I knew a lot more about the situation from a legal perspective back then than I do now. So I would have to go back and research it, but just my gut feeling is, yeah, we need to, I hate to leave things in limbo. And wherever you can get clarity and take action, I think that's the thing to do. In this case, I'm not sure what that is right now. So, you know, one could argue maybe that they're in the best place, they're locked up and out of pocket. And that's the best place we could have them, because if we took them out and killed them right now, then certainly that would be, that'd be hard, probably hard to defend and justify. So what else do you do with them? You don't want to turn them loose, maybe. So I'm just not sure what the right thing to do is there. I would just have to have a lot more information. But generally, as a general rule, well, I think you're always better to have things follow a clear process and deal with it.
Colonel, on behalf of AIM and everyone here, we thank you for your service to our country again.
And well, thank you, John.
The extraordinary sacrifice you made, not only as an Air Force pilot, but then as a prisoner of war in North Vietnam. And I urge everybody to get your book, Leading with Honor, Leadership Lessons from the Hanoi Hilton.
Well, thank you. And, you know, we have a great country, and the foundation of it, I think, is about truth and accountability. And wherever we can have truth and accountability in our business, in our churches, in our government, we'll all be better served.
Well said. Thank you, Colonel.
Thanks. Bye-bye.
Take care. I was reading recently how some of these guys at the Hanoi Hilton had to spend their time. One in particular would build his house brick by brick every day and essentially dismantle it the next day and then rebuild it the next day in his mind. Like in his mind, brick by brick, room by room, just to pass the time. In between torture sessions.
I love that man.
Yeah, he's a great guy.
And he's humble, and you can tell he has a gentle heart. I mean, considering all that's happened to him and all the times he was tortured, he seems like a very, very sincere, gentle man.
I love that. I love his statement. I choose not to hate Jane Fonda because I don't want to give her a piece of my heart or my head. I just prefer not to waste any energy thinking about Jane Fonda. Thank you, Colonel. Much appreciated.